I would like to invite our next speaker, Dr. Madhuri Lokapure, for delivering her thoughts about CT-guided procedure in the visceral pain. She is the organizing chairman of ICRA Pain 2017. She does not need any more introduction. Welcome, ma'am, to the dais.
Hi, good evening, everybody. I hope people are enjoying the conference. Good to know that. Now I'll cooperate with Dr. Gautam Das, and we'll quickly run through this presentation. So that the next session of clinical workshop can start, like whenever we will have some time for that. No. Presentation. This is not a very high technological thing. This is basically a bread and butter for a pain physician, because mostly we are referred cases with abdominal pain and pelvic pain coming from malignancy origin. And the procedures, nowadays we have switched over to CT-guided procedures because that gives us a very good target orientation. And we are very sure when we are using neurolytic solutions, whether we are at the right target, whether the spread is absolutely correct. I'll just go through the how we do the procedure itself rather than going into details of each block. So basically, these procedures are done always under some guidance or the other. A group from Delhi, which is led by Dr. Sushma Bhatnagar, they are using USG guidance and they are proponents of that system. Fluoroscopically, people have been doing for many years, and nowadays we have started doing it under CT. The basic problems why we are doing a CT-guided procedure is because pelvic malignancies or abdominal pelvic malignancies can be silent. So by the time they are diagnosed, the anatomy is distorted itself. And by the time they end up with pain physician, we are never sure about the growth which is occurring over there. Inability to take oral medication, especially in the upper GI conditions. So in a multimodal analgesia setting, we must offer interventional blocks as early in the disease as possible, because once the plexus has been invaded by the tumor, then many a times after the pilot scan, we have to abandon the procedure and take the patients out. So these are some of the major indications for doing percutaneous CT-guided blocks. The blocks which we commonly do are the celiac, superior hypogastric, and ganglion impar block. As I have already mentioned, using CT, because it gives you an excellent visualization about the structures as compared to fluoroscopy, where you can see only the bony part of it. Ability to reconstruct a three-dimensional picture of the deeper tissues, so that in case you need to adjust the angle in three-dimensional, because it's not a unidirectional entry when you are putting it into deeper abdominal tissues, especially coming from prone position. And as against USG guidance, the prone position allows sparing of the needle penetration of the viscera, because most of these USG guided things are done in supine position, where you always have to penetrate the all the viscera, even for the celiac plexus block. The incidence of complication has been the lowest, as a paper by Nietzsche and colleagues has been presented. And even in our clinical practice, because we are very sure about putting the neurolytic solution where it should be put, we also endorse that. However, it is not without disadvantages. Whenever you are doing a CT guidance, first you have to be very good putting your needle in under fluoroscopy, because there is no real-time guidance here. So you have to again put the needle, adjust it, go back, and again take a scan again. So that increases radiation for the patient quite a lot. It increases your procedure time as well, especially for blocks like superior hypogastric plexus block. How can you minimize the radiation? By using newer software technologies where you don't need a very high-quality picture like you would require for diagnostic purposes. Individualize your area of intervention. There is a biopsy mode in most of the newer CT scans, so that only a very thin slices can be taken of a very small targeted region. Thirdly, use lower radiation. Your technical assistant for CT scan can do that for you. Common contraindications apply to all the blocks. Informed consent, absolutely necessary. especially in Maharashtra settings. I don't know how things are working out in other states as well. Mostly all these procedures are done under local guidance, local anesthesia. Very mild sedation, if required for the patient to lie still, can be given. Material and equipment, you require neurolytic agents, your Chiba needles, either 20 or 22 gauge, with markings on it is more convenient. Non-ionic, water-soluble, iodinated contrast, pending draping kits, which are very important for your aseptic precautions, IV access, and intra-procedural monitoring. Patient position can be prone or supine depending upon advance of the disease. The celiac plexus block, basically all the structures which I have mentioned, it is for the upper abdominal structures. This plexus is located anterior to the aorta in the retroperitoneal space between T12 to L2. We don't ever see the plexus as such, but what we see is origin of the celiac artery and origin of superior mesenteric artery. Like I have mentioned, shown here, between the two arteries, the plexus is situated, and different approaches have been advocated. So it could be behind the crura, it could be in front of the crura, it could be side by side to the artery, or it could be transaortic as well. I like to disturb the tissues as little as possible, so whenever we can take a path which does not go through the viscera, I would always prefer to take that one. This is how the importance of CT-guided procedures comes in, because there is advanced malignancy. Like if you're doing it only under fluoroscopy control, you would never see this soft tissue thing which is going on here. And in case you inject into the tumor cell or some other structure which has been pushed over there by the tumor, then what you would have actually is lysis and necrosis of that tumor mass or the organ mass instead of hitting the nerve plexus. So all these procedures are basically advanced malignancies, and that's why you can see and confirm before you put your neurolytic solutions. So most of the cases are like this, so you have spread going anteriorly. Usually we do only a single needle technique, because what we see under CT scan is that when you're putting the dye in, so long as it is covering the anterolateral surface of the aorta, either in the front or retrocrurally, you don't need to put the second needle at all. The common side effects would be orthostatic hypotension, diarrhea. These are to be expected because of the sympathetic blockade. However, rarely paraplegia can be seen, which is rarely mentioned into the literature also. Spinal epidural injection under CT never occurs. Aortic or vena cava puncture can occur because it's not a real-time procedure, and sometimes you may advance the needle ahead accidentally. However, diagnosis is very apparent. Retroperitoneal hemorrhage can occur in some of these patients. Vital organ injury with a 20 or 22 gauge needle, that's not something I think we should be very worried about. Pneumothorax is a very complication which is very much avoidable, and that should be done. So artery of Adamke is, as you know, that it arises from the radiculomedullary branch of the posterior branch of the lumbar artery, and this is how it travels and goes inside. So usually we take the left-sided approach, and you have to be very careful about how the dye is spreading. Another thing like pneumothorax, which I mentioned, just check your levels. So if you can see the sliver of lung coming down here, even if the patient is taking a deep breath or if patient has got advanced malignancy, avoid this level and go down below. As far as superior hypogastric plexus block is concerned, there are multiple issues to it, because traditionally we have been taught that you give it through the prone position, you have to position both the needles. However, what we don't take into consideration is that the plexus is actually located anterior to the vertebra, more in the central manner. It is not in the side. So that is the reason why you have to put the, if you're putting two needles from behind, you have to put them on both the sides, because the drug may or may not go there. Under CT scan, when you're putting the dye, you will find that even a single needle, if the dye is satisfactory, crossing the midline, you don't need to put the second needle in, whether you are going in prone. In supine, of course, you go directly and hit the plexus where it is located, so you don't need to put the second needle in. So this is a traditional approach which we used to do earlier, and this is how we got the dye spread. What I realized was that there are very few complications reported with superior hypogastric plexus block. However, as you can see, sometimes the drug can travel behind and go enter into the intervertebral foramina and can cause damage to the spinal cord or the nerves which are coming out of there. If you're going anteriorly under the CT scan, you go it after the aorta has bifurcated, and it is at the anterior border of the L5 vertebra. So this is how the plexus is located. I mean, there is not a discernible ganglia like you would have in ganglion impar or you would have in celiac plexus, but it's more like a confluence of all these nerves out here. It's a plexus. So it is situated right there in the center part of the vertebral body. And therefore, the only thing is that whenever you're doing anything in supine position, person has to breathe. So even if you ask him to hold his breath or do whatever it is, the abdomen keeps moving. So skin is not exactly going to help your cause. So what we do here is a very jugaad kind of a method. What we do is we just take various needles in their pack itself, and then we put them on the anterior part of the abdomen. And then we take the pilot scan so that you can locate your skin entry point where you want to go inside. Once you have marked that, it is a very easy job because you just have to go vertically downwards till you hit the bone. So there is nothing else you can go. As long as you are sitting on a bone, you are in a safe place. This is how we do the marking. First you take a lateral scan, identify your target area, whether you are going for superior hypogastric, you are looking any place between L4 lower border to S1 lower border. And then find out the right place where you want to go. Don't choose the level at which there is a disc, because disc is soft and you might penetrate into the disc causing discitis. So always make sure that you are hitting the bone. Once you have done that, and you have done the marking with the use of infrared, put your needle in and see this, check out the spread. This is how the spread should look like in a lateral position. And this is a 3D reconstruction. Like I mentioned earlier, in a CT, that's a beautiful part of it that you can have, actually, you can see it in three-dimensional views. Ganglion impar block, there are many more conditions. It is basically for the pelvic pain, either from the malignancy or proctalgia, urethral pain, vulvodynia, many other non-malignant conditions too. Again, the same thing. While marking, what we do is, once you have taken the pilot scans, which are axial, choose your level. There are two levels you need to mark. One is the depth. Where do you want to go? You want to go anterior to this junction between the sacrococcygeal junction. And second point is from the midline to whichever side you are going to choose it. I always do my blocks using a single needle technique, unless we really are unsuccessful, there is some fibrosis. In that case, we put the needle from the other side. It is less traumatic, and this is how the dye spreads. That's how it will look like. And this is retroperitoneal space is a free space. So you don't need to put it at one level. It is going to go up and down. This is just one 3D reconstruction I thought I'll share with you. And this is how in 3D we find out. I don't know, did you see that? Do you want me to play it again? It was too fast, right? Okay, so this is where we went in at the sacrococcygeal junction. And then you can see that dye spreading all over. So in summary, I would like to say that CT-guided sympathetic blocks for abdominal visceral pain are beneficial in a multimodal pain therapy. Thank you very much.
Question answer, should we take, or should we go to the next session directly?
I think you go to the next session. I can answer them outside.
Already we are late, so we are going to the next session directly.